We had just looked at the shattering coefficient as a first tool to treat the case of infinite function classes and to still prove generalization bounds. As I said at the end of that lecture, shattering coefficients are really hard to compute, and in particular for real-world function classes, this is typically quite difficult. Now we are going to look at a different tool, which is called the VC dimension for Wapnik-Chervonenkis. VC, Wapnik-Chervonenkis, these were the two people who invented that. And now it's another combinatorial tool. Let's look at it. We start right away with the definition. So we're given a data space X and a function class F. And we now say a function class shatters a set of points if this function class can realize all possible labelings on this data set, on this set of points. So there are two endpoints. We have 2 to the power of n many different binary labelings, and we say a function class shatters this particular data set if it can achieve all the labelings, which means that if we look at how many functions are in the function space restricted to these data points, then there are all possible functions, namely 2 to the power of n. Okay, so this means for this particular set of points, we can realize all labelings of this data set. No matter where we put plus ones and minus ones, we can realize the labeling. Now, now we define what is the VC dimension of a function class. And this is now, as opposed to the shattering coefficient, not a quantity that also depends on n. It is a quantity that just depends on the function class. So the VC dimension of a function class is defined as the largest number of data points such that there exists a sample of this size, n, that can still be shattered by the function class. So the formal definition is, where should I start reading? So the VC dimension is the maximum integer of n, so it's an integer, it's a number attached to this function class, such that there exists a set of n data points in our data space, such that this set can be shattered by the function class in the sense that the function class can realize all possible labelings. And if this maximum does not exist, then we simply say the VC dimension is infinite. Now maybe let's digest this and compare it mentally a bit to the shattering coefficient, because, I mean, they are in some sense similar, but in some sense also different. So the first important thing is that the shattering coefficient depends on one particular sample size, and here we get rid of this dependency on the sample size by saying we look at different sample sizes, and as soon as we end up at a sample size where we find one particular data set that cannot be shattered anymore, then this is where we stop, and this is where we know that then we have found the VC dimension. Let's maybe try to look at some examples. And maybe I also do it in parallel on the iPad because it's easier to see. So our data space in this particular example is again the space X is the real line. And our functions consist of closed intervals. So they have the form AB, where A is a number, so A and B are simple real numbers. These are closed intervals. It's not the interval, but the characteristic function of those intervals. Let me just plot one. Here we have the real line, here we have A, here we have B. And our functions look like this. Okay, 1 on the interval, 0 outside. And now the question is, what is the VC dimension? And to find out what the VC dimension of a set of points is, you simply start, again, a bit similar as we did in the shattering coefficient. You start with small sets of points and then try to see whether you can, or small sizes of sets of points, and you start to see whether you can find a data set that can be shattered. So we start, maybe n equals 1 is maybe too simplistic. We start with a data set consisting of 2 points. So let's say we start with n equals 2. We have our real line. We have 2 points. Oh, sorry, this point here and this point here. And now the question is, can we shatter it? That means, can we realize all possible labelings on this particular set of points? And here the answer is, of course, yes. We can put the interval, if, for example, if we want to have that the first point has label plus 1 and the second one should get label 0, then we simply choose the function that looks a function that looks like this. Then the first point has label plus 1, the second point has label 0. We can do it the other way around. We can have the second point being 1, the first point not 1. We can have both being 1 or both being 0. So there are 4 different labelings. We can realize all of them, which means that the VC dimension has to be at least 2. Because, and this is now something one really has to be careful about, we don't need to prove that all, like in principle, that all sets of 2 points can be shattered. It just says, as soon as we found one data set that can be shattered, we know the VC dimension needs to be larger than this one. So we just need to, for each number n, we just need to find one data set that is shattered, and then it's fine. So now let's look at the case n equals 3. Look again at the real line. We have 3 points. And now again, let's try to find out whether we can realize all possible labelings. And now my answer is no. On this data set, we cannot realize all possible labelings. There is one labeling that we definitely cannot achieve, namely the one where this guy has plus 1 and these two guys have, where this guy has 0. Yeah, I erase it again to make it more visible. So this guy has 0, no, this guy has 0, this has plus 1, this is plus 1. So we have essentially a step function with the step going down in the middle. And this is a step function that is not in our function class. So this labeling we cannot realize with our particular function class. And now we can stop, and now we can say, so the VC dimension has to be 2. Let us maybe go back once more to the definition to verify that we really did it correctly. And also myself, I always need to think about this very carefully, and sometimes I also get it wrong. So we look for the maximum n such that there exists a data set that can be shattered. And now we need to look at n equals 3. And the question is, does there exist a data set that can be shattered that has 3 points? And what this example shows that we have here on the iPad is that no matter how, this is sort of independent of the positions of the points. So no matter how you're going to put 3 points on this real line, you will always not be able to shatter it. So for all data sets of n equals 3 size, we cannot shatter these data sets. And now we know that the VC dimension is 2. You check for n equals 2, does there exist a data set that can be shattered? Yes, fine, you can continue. You check for n equals 3, is there a data set that can be shattered? If yes, you can continue. If no, if you don't find one, you need to prove that for all data sets, they cannot be shattered. And then you found the VC dimension. I have a couple of more examples on the slides. It's all these simple toy examples which don't really help you in practice, but help you maybe to get a bit of intuition. So now let's again show this on the iPad. Our space X is R2 now, and the function class consists, so we have data points on the plane, and our function class consists of X's parallel rectangles. And now the question is, inside the rectangle it's plus 1, outside it's minus 1. And now is the question, does there exist a point configuration, say, of n equals 4 that can be shattered? And for n equals 4, you can find a point configuration that can be shattered. And if you look at this particular point configuration here, now assume, say, just one of these 2 points. So if you want to have this point plus 1, easy. So the same for all other points. If you want to have 2 points like this, being plus 1 and the other one being negative, easy. And also if you would have like the 2 opposite points, for example, these 2 points being plus 1 and everybody else minus 1, also works. So you can convince yourself that if you construct a data set like this, this data set can be shattered. So we know the VC dimension has to be greater or equal to 4 because we found a data set that can be shattered. And observe here, I have this remark even on the slide, we cannot shatter all data sets of 4 points. So here's an example of a data set of 4 points that cannot be shattered. If you have 1 point in the interior and you want to have everybody outside being plus one, but the point in the interior being zero, then this doesn't work with this particular function class. Now the next, so we know we found a data set for 4 points that can be shattered. Now we look for 5 points. And now you can try to convince yourself that no data set of 5 points can be shattered. And I don't want to sort of spell out the proof, but the general idea is consider a set of 5 points, then and you now try to find what are the extreme points. So I try to maybe show it on the iPad. Say we have 5 points, and now you look at what are the extreme points if you approach them from left and right and from top and bottom. So sort of if I have a hyperplane coming parallel to the axis and that comes from the left, when does it touch the first point? So in this particular case, which I have on the iPad, so this here is the extreme point, this guy on the left side, we have one extreme point on the right side, then we have one extreme point from the bottom and one extreme point from the top. And then you can now prove if you have 5 data points, there has to exist 1 data point that is not an extreme point in both axis parallel directions. So you have it sort of sitting inside. It might also still sit on the line, but somehow then it's not on the other extreme. And then you can prove that such a data set you can never shatter, and then you're done. Here's yet another example, just to keep on presenting examples, but I'm not going to go through it very intensely. So again, we're in R2. Our function class is now more complex. It's not just like axis parallel squares, but it's polygons with D corners, convex polygons with D corners, something like this. And you can prove that the VC dimension of this function class is 2D plus 1. So, and the lower bound is in fact that surprisingly elegant and easy. So whenever you put, so for the lower bound, you need to find a data set of, for some n, you want to find a data set that can be shattered. And now because we want to prove that the VC dimension is 2D plus 1, we need to look at 2D plus 1 points and see whether we can shatter this data set. Whether we can find a data set that we can shatter. And to construct such a data set, what do? We put the points on a circle, d plus 1 points on a circle. We give them arbitrary colors, because we need to make sure, like if we can color them blue and red in all possible ways that is possible, then we shatter the data set. So you just pick a coloring, and then essentially you want to say, so for example, everybody who is red should be plus 1 and everybody who is blue should be 0. So if you have less than d points, red d points, then you can construct a polygon using, you're allowed to construct polygons with D corners. So then you can construct such a polygon, and everybody in this polygon or on the corner of such a polygon is going to be red, and everybody else is outside and is blue, is 0. And the other way around, if your data set is more than D red points, you can use a different construction. You slightly put the corner of the polygon outside such that it still does not touch these blue points. And you can convince yourself that by this, again, you can shatter the you can classify the data set in the way the color is given here. And so in this way, you can realize all possible colors on D plus 1 data points. So this is the lower bound. So it tells us that the VC dimension is 2D plus 1, at least 2D plus 1. Now we want to know that it's not 2D plus 2. And this is a bit of a more technical argument. And I don't want to give it here on the slide. If you want, you can read it up. It's written in a couple of the textbooks, more on the combinatorial VC dimension kind of textbooks. One last example. Our space is R. Our function class is all sine waves with different frequencies. So this T parameter, which tells you essentially how dense these sine waves are. If you look at this function class, then the VC dimension is infinite. Because no matter if for each n, you can put your points in such a way and use a sine wave of such high frequency that you can realize all possible labelings on this particular data set. And then you have shattered it, and you can do this for all numbers of data points. So here the VC dimension would be infinite. Okay, and now come some examples where we don't have the proofs on the slide as well, which in fact show that the VC dimension is something that can at least make helpful statements for some function classes that occur in practice. Namely, if we look at linear functions. So if you're in the space RD, you have a d-dimensional Euclidean space, and your function class is linear hyperplanes, then you can prove that the VC dimension of your function class is d plus 1. So you're in a d-dimensional space, the VC dimension is d plus 1. And the proof is surprisingly not extremely complicated if you know what the steps are. We might put it on the exercise sheet. The other thing that's important also for support vector machines has to do with margins, with hyperplanes with a certain margin. So this is now really has been proved in particular for support vector machines. So our data space is again RD. We have a certain parameter rho, which is going to be the margin, and we say f rho, the function space f rho, are all linear functions that have margin as at least rho. And then you can prove you need to make one more assumption, namely that the data points sit within a sphere of a certain radius, because this sort of, you need this assumption because the margin rho is an absolute value, and like if you blow up your data set but you don't blow up the margin, then somehow the statement wouldn't really make sense. So you need to relate the size of the margin somehow to the width of your data set. And so if you say my data set lives inside of a ball of radius r, then you can prove that the VC dimension of this function class is either the minimum of d or this term r square over rho square, which essentially tells you the larger rho is, the smaller is the VC dimension. Because observe, like if this margin is really small, then you fall back in the standard case of arbitrary linear hyperplanes, and your VC dimension would be d plus 1. But if your margin is really large, then this term here, this r square over rho square, this term eventually is going to be smaller than d. So your VC dimension decreases even beyond the one that you know from linear functions. So if you're able to classify all your data points with a high margin, then this is a good sign. Okay. Now, the reason is, why do we really look at this VC dimension? It sounds like a combinatorial tool, but at least it's not immediately obvious that by looking at the VC dimension, we would be able to prove a generalization bound, because it does not really count the number of functions. It just gives sort of this combinatorial threshold where you say, well, below the VC dimension, I can always shatter. Above the VC dimension, I cannot shatter anymore. Intuitively, I mean, somehow it makes sense that if we're after a statement for n to infinity, we are interested in this tail regime where we are at large sample sizes. So even though we can shatter all our data points, all the small data sets, maybe eventually we're in this part where we cannot shatter the data sets anymore. And now the question is really, how much smaller do the function classes get? So in principle, you could think about saying, well, maybe I can't realize all functions, but all but one function. So then I would still have an exponential number of functions. And then again, the generalization bound probably wouldn't work, because if we think again about this log shattering dimension, we would have the log shattering coefficient being polynomial, or the shattering coefficient being polynomial. But nobody tells us that it is polynomial. We just state, is it 2 to the power of n, or is it something less? And the something less could be just 1 less. And the bound still wouldn't give us any good result here. So the question is really, what do we know about the number of functions in a function space that has a small VC dimension if the sample size is large? And now here's this very, very surprising, cool, great statement, the Sauer-Schieler lemma, which in fact has been proved in many different communities. It's a combinatorial lemma. There exist many, many proofs out there, and these proofs are really nice and elegant. We might want to do one of them in the exercises as well. But maybe for now, let's first of all look at the statement. Assume we have a function class with a finite VC dimension d. Then the number of functions, so the shattering coefficient, so the number of functions that we have when we look at n particular data points, is bounded by this expression here. Now, this is still a bit of an inconvenient expression, and it's not immediately clear whether this is good or bad, but you can bound this expression further and see that this expression is bounded by, so the shattering coefficient is bounded by E n over d to the power of d, where E is the Euler number, n is the sample size you're looking at, and d is your VC dimension. And in particular, like, this is of the order n to the power of d, so it's polynomial in d, and it's not exponential anymore. And this is really, really cool and also very surprising, and I have a figure on the next slide to illustrate it. So again, and let's look at this figure at the bottom of the slide. So this arrow depicts the number of sample points, n, going to infinity. And then we look at this place where we have n equals d. Now, and we assume that our space, our function space, has VC dimension d. So now what happens below, if we have fewer data points than d? So we're in the regime where data points, maybe 5 data points, and 5 is smaller than d. Then in principle, the shattering coefficient for this number n can be exponential, because we don't make any statement here. And the Sauer-Scheeler lemma also doesn't make any statement. But what the Sauer-Scheeler lemma says is, once we go beyond this d, the function space only grows polynomially in n, n to the power of d. And this, I find, I mean, this is really, really surprising. So you have this transition point, and nobody really tells you that there is a transition from exponential many number of functions to polynomial, but this is now what the Sauer-Scheeler lemma gives us. And then, in this regime, we can invoke our standard generalization bound with a polynomial number of functions, and then we would get consistency. Okay, and now this is what we now see as a result here. You can now plug the Sauer-Scheeler lemma into the theorem we had before. So the theorem before is the one where we here have the shattering coefficient, and now we know that the shattering coefficient is at most 2 to the d over d. We plug it in here, and then this is the result. So the result reads as follows. Let f be a function class with VC dimension d. Then with probability at least 1 minus delta, all functions satisfy that the true risk of the function deviates from the empirical risk by at most this expression. And this expression is now, so here we replace the shattering coefficient by the VC dimension, so here we have now this expression in d. So I put the d, so because we have en, so if you go back to the Sauer-Scheeler lemma, this is the expression here. Now you have the log of this expression, so we have d times log of this expression, and this is what we have here, d times log of this expression. And that's cool. And in particular, it implies that if d is a finite quantity, so observe d is not a quantity that would grow with n. We have a function class, and if the function class has a finite VC dimension d, then d is a constant in this bound. So we can ignore all the constants in the limit for n to infinity. Then we have here log n over n, and this is going to go to zero. And then we get consistency. Cool, isn't it? So more generally, you can also prove that the theorem holds also the other way around. So you really have that the empirical risk minimization is consistent with respect to f if and only if the VC dimension is finite. Because observe the way we stated the statement earlier is if we just said, like, this generalization bound just says if the VC dimension is finite, then we get consistency, but it also holds the other way around. There's one more thing that I also want to show you and to point you out, because often it is sort of what people always try to figure out is how many samples would I need before I sort of get to a regime where I have enough data points to have some reasonably small confidence intervals about my result. As I already said, this is something that typically in machine learning is not possible. We can't get as strong confidence intervals as in the statistics, for example, for a t-test or so. But you still, at least you can get a feeling for the order of magnitude, or sort of how fast does the number of sample points needs to grow such that you end up in a regime where you can be reasonably confident about your result. And this is what we now see on the slide. So if we have such a generalization bound, you can always ask, how many samples do we need to have to achieve error at most epsilon? Okay. And now what we do is, I mean, the error in this generalization bound here is this expression here. And now if you want to say, well, this expression here, the square root expression, should be at most epsilon, then we can solve for n and see how many n's do we need. So we do this, we set the expression here, epsilon, we equal it to the square root deviation term. You solve it for n and you simply ignore all the constants. We're just after a feeling, a gut feeling, like trying to give us some intuition. And then what you get is you need of the order of d over epsilon square many sample points, which says the number of sample points grows linearly with the VC dimension. So if you have the choice between a couple of function classes, then, and the VC dimension is a bit different, then the number of samples also needs to be a bit different, but not so much different, just linearly in D. And of course you have this epsilon term that somehow needs to be in the denominator or so, because the more confidence you want to have, the more sample points you would probably need.